Once upon a time. When I first visited Fishisle Atoll 3 decades before this film was recorded, the people on the outer islands in State of Yap in Micronesia lived much like their ancestors had done for centuries. They were people of the open sea. They were great fishermen and experts in canoe building and navigating the ocean over long distances with their traditional outrigger canoes. They had a long history and a rich culture. People had lived on the tiny remote islands for over 1,000 years. Back then, the natural environment on Fishisle Atoll was probably the closest one could get to a paradise on Earth. The lagoon was surrounded by a living coral reef, and the white sandy beaches were the epitome of a tropical island dream. The islands were covered with coconut palms and other trees that covered the island's interior and made it a wild and dense jungle. Contact with the outside world was limited and stress was unknown. Fishisle Atoll is considered one of the most remote communities in the world. The only official connection was a ship that belonged to the small island state and served the outer islands only about once every 2 months. I spent a few months on Fishisle Atoll, where I documented the culture and daily life for a photo documentary account of the last traditional living peoples in the Pacific Ocean. During the stay, I was adopted into Pius Moppis, who was the island's best fisherman and very helpful and hospitable. In addition to my adoptive father Pius, the family comprised of my mother Maggie and grandmother Mariana and the kids Angie, Pius, Cipriano, Vicky, Rupai and Tom and Jerry. After returning home to Denmark, I often missed my family on the islands, but time passed and many waves washed ashore. It wasn't until decades later I got in touch with one of my adoptive brothers who had moved to Hawaii and found me on the internet. After that, I got in contact with others who had been children and young people while I was on the island, but who were now grown and had moved away. Among them were several members of my adoptive family who now lived on the island of Guam, which is a US territory north of Yap State in Micronesia. After some years of contact on the internet, several of my adoptive family members urged me to go back to the atoll where a part of the family still lived. I just had to buy an airplane ticket to Guam and they would organize the rest. After 3 decades of absence, I returned to Micronesia, where I reunited with my family in Guam. They had arranged welcome and farewell party with lovely food, music and dance. After a few days in Guam, I flew on to Yap, which is a main island in Yap State, the westernmost of the four small island states in the Federated States of Micronesia. Micronesia, covering a sea area of 2,900 million square miles in the western Pacific, includes several other small island states. The total land area in Micronesia is only about 1,500 square miles, spread over 2,100 islands, of which only around 100 are inhabited. The state of Yap has a population of about 19,000 people, of whom approximately 12,000 live on the island of Yap, and the rest on the outer islands. Also on Yap was a great party. The feast on Yap took place in a large gathering cottage near the harbor of the small capital of Colonia, where I was welcomed with traditional dance and happy New Year party. During my stay on Yap, I lived with the Wapi tribe and experienced staying in several places together with people from Fajilab Atoll. There are two small communities in Yap where some 50 people from Fajilab Atoll stay. I stayed on Yap for 10 days before the ship departed. We were a group of 16 people going to Fajilab Atoll, including the two chiefs and their families from the atoll's two inhabited islands. There is only one ship servicing the outer islands. The field trip goes on about every 2 months and is the only official connection to the remote outer islands. All passengers slept on the deck where we stayed with our luggage. At departure from Yap, the ship carried 169 passengers, who, apart from me, were all native islanders. The ship visited all the inhabited outer islands along the way and brought different supplies to the isolated communities, but also a great opportunity to meet friends and relatives and hear the latest news from other islands. Some had been away for many years due to education or work and were welcomed with wreaths of flowers. When I went ashore on the islands, I walked along the beach and enjoyed the peaceful environment before going back to the ship. Usually the ship anchored one day each place, some places only a few hours. After a sea voyage of 1 week visiting 5 different islands on the way after departure from Yap, the ship finally approached Fitzgerald Atoll an early morning. The measure of peak, the smallest island, is 450 by 450 yards. During my first visit in 1986, only 40 people stayed on peak, but now the population was 96. Fitzgerald, the largest island, is 800 yards long and 450 yards wide. Before, 135 people lived there, and now the population had dropped to 120. The southernmost island yet measures 750 by 250 yards and is uninhabited due to ghosts. The 3 small islands did not look like much seen from the bridge of the ship. The island's highest point is only 12 feet above sea level. Returning after 3 decades was like waking up after a trip in a time machine. My adoptive family had long ago abandoned the small palm leaf hut and moved into a concrete house with a tin roof. My adoptive father, Pius Moppy, had died 4 years earlier and was buried in front of the little house. My mother, Maggie, lived in the house, as did Grandma Mariana, who with her over 90 years was the island's oldest. In the house also lived grandchildren and other family members, including my brother Jerry, who during my first stay was a little fellow of 5-6 years old. Now he was over 6 feet tall, a teacher and employee at the island school. Just few hours after the ship had left, I was invited for a fishing trip outside the lagoon together with Jerry and a couple of other men in order to get some fresh fish for dinner. Finally, I was back on the island again. The family lived centrally in the village next to the church, which compared to earlier days was a huge edifice. Previously, the church was a palm leaf hut that looked like the other huts, just a big bit bigger. The islanders became Catholics after World War II, when a Catholic missionary went ashore. The islanders rapidly converted as their traditional god Uwapi had announced that there would soon be a new administration which used a cross as a symbol. Uwapi was the spirit of a little girl who after her death had been worshipped as a guardian angel. Uwapi could suddenly appear as a bird, but she could always be found in a rainbow. Another big change, which did not exist when I first visited the atoll, was the kindergarten. The kindergarten was very popular and supported by everyone on the island. Although there were many changes, the only contact with the outside world remained a small VHF shortwave radio, which was in the office at the school, that was managed by Tom, my second adoptive brother on the island, and the island's school principal. My brothers Tom and Jerry were both trained as teachers and had returned to teach the children on their native island.
They provide foods for our house materials. They provide woods for building houses and medicine. So all these things, they came from plants. So where did plants grow?
They grow
in
the soil.
Okay, plants grow in the soil. That's why soil is very important to us.
People of Fitchailap Atoll were concerned about the environment on the tiny islands. The impact of climate change was a recurring topic of conversation when the men met in front of the men's house. Everyone was worried about the climate change. The melting of the ice sheet in Greenland over the past two decades resulted in an average sea level rise of 0.6 inches per year in the western Pacific near the equator. So over 20 years the sea has risen 1 foot. The children on the islands had never seen the rich diversity on the coral reef when it was alive, or experienced the beach before erosion really took off. Colossal changes had happened all around the atoll. One of the things that struck me the most was to see how things were at the coral reef. I almost had a shock when I saw all the dead corals at low tide. When I went swimming out to my old favorite place in the lagoon, where before I enjoyed going snorkeling, I became so sad that moisture appeared in the mask from the inside, so the glass began to fog. When last I saw the reef, it was a wonderful underwater garden full of living creatures of all shapes and colors. Now it was completely dead. The corals and the algae it lived in symbiosis with had not been able to withstand the record high temperatures. The reef had started to die about 15 years earlier, which had severely affected all life in the coral reef. Many species had disappeared, died, or gone elsewhere. The old ecosystem of the coral reef was completely collapsed, so almost no fish were left in the lagoon. The chief had forbidden the use of harpoons and fishing spears to protect the population of fish, just as he had banned fishing with nets. The only fishing gear that was otherwise used in the lagoon were fish hooks with fishing line and a short metal rod bent at the end like a hook, used for catching clams, lobsters, and octopus. Most families had their own fish traps, which were inspected about every other day. Sometimes the fish traps were empty, while other days full enough for everyone in the family to get a small fish. Usually they went out, 3-4 men together, emptying their traps from a fiberglass boat with an outboard engine. The islands were 100% self-sufficient when it came to food. In the cultivated gardens on the island there grew taro, bananas, sweet potatoes, papaya, and other crops. One day I joined a group of men who went to Yat, the uninhabited island, to get wood for a traditional family hut. The wood was floated to Fishailip where it was chopped and adjusted with axes in front of the men house. A few weeks later, the new family hut was built, supported by the whole community, with subsequent partying, singing and dancing. Despite all the changes that have taken place, the spirit of the islanders and their way of living was in many ways still intact.
Yeah.
After 3 weeks on Fish Island, I was sailed to the small island Pig, as during the party on Yap, Chief Somai from Pig had invited me to stay there so I could experience the atoll's smallest island. Although there were a few pigs on Pig Island, the name of the island had nothing to do with pigs. The traditional name of the island is Pig Mal, which means the bird's island. On Pig, I lived in a small hut, located for itself near the island's northernmost spit of land, which was uninhabited. When I moved into the hut, it was leaking and ramshackle. It was only used as a storage place for coconut shells, used as firewood for cooking. But Chief Somai and his family helped restore the hut, so rain and wind were kept reasonably out. It was a wonderful spot. The hut was just 10 meters from the beach, and I gradually adapted so well that I felt like the richest man in the world. Lizards, geckos, crabs and insects were my roommates. Most of one side of the hut I left open to the outside. I enjoyed the island's natural environment, which surrounded the hut on all sides. In the woods and on the beach there were lots of birds, including migratory birds that, like I, were on winter visit from far northern distant skies where it was now cold and dark. However, the birds were not my only neighbors. Chief Somai and his family lived in the forest about 100 meters behind my hut. They took care of me in every way. The hospitality was tremendous. Each morning Somai came and sat down in the opening of my hut. Sometimes he sat for a while calling the birds. We started the day with fresh coconut juice or a cup of coffee and a chat about the weather or what else there was to talk about on a tiny island, which at times was quite a lot. The chief was by far the most active fisherman on the island. If the weather permitted it, he paddled outside the lagoon every evening before sunset. Here he would cast a coral block as anchor and sit down to fish. Usually he returned with his catch after midnight. The big catches were done with fiberglass dinghy and outboard motor. Sometimes it was quite big yellowfin tuna that were caught. When that happened, there was food. As there was not yet freezers on the island, the catch could not be stored, so the people on the islands lived from hand to mouth and never caught more than the population could eat during a day or two. Sea turtles are another source of proteins. The outer islands in State of Yap are one of the last places in the world where the indigenous people are still allowed to hunt sea turtles. This is done according to old traditions and limited to their own personal domestic consumption on a particular season, so the turtle population is not damaged. The hunters usually only catch one sea turtle at a time, and only the very largest and oldest that do not have many years left to live. Catch is going on with traditional harpoon outside the lagoon, where a man or two jumps into the ocean from a canoe or dinghy and swim around close to the outer side of the reef watching for a sea turtle. Long-standing scientific studies on some of the outer islands have shown that the traditional hunting do not affect the turtle population. The area's population of sea turtles is one of the best in the world. The worst threats to the global sea turtle population in our time include climate change, habitat destruction, commercial fishermen's net, oil and plastic pollution. Peak Island was the cultural stronghold of the Uwapi tribe. Every afternoon the men met in the circle in front of the men house to sing, tell stories and drink the traditional alcoholic drink tuba, which is palm wine made of juice from coconut trees. The remains of the sacred house of the traditional god Uwapi is located on Peak, where before the spirit of Uwapi was worshipped. I was not bored. Every day I went for a walk around the island, enjoying the beach, the view of the sea, and the sound of waves that could always be heard wherever I was. I lived close to the beach and the sea and experienced how the ongoing daily erosion at high tide affected the coast, which over the past 15 to 20 years had caused the islands to become smaller. In some places, the land area had shrunk over 50 yards which of course worried the people who lived on the islands. Sumai's mother was dying. Soon the sound of her breath and her voice would disappear like footprints on the beach at the next wave. And experience sorrow and joy. On my daily walks around the island, I was usually alone. Often I had my diving mask and snorkel in the basket, as well as some fishing gear. On the reef in the lagoon west of Peak was a coral garden that was protected from the warm sea current from the east, which had made the rest of the coral reef collapse. In a part of this area, the chief had prohibited fishing, so it served as a reserve chamber, having a reasonable fish stock and living corals where I enjoyed snorkeling. Another place I liked to dwell was on some coral rocks that lay out towards a place with strong current. Off the coast the water was 12 to 16 feet deep with a sandy bottom and scattered coral blocks. It was a great place to fish, so occasionally I could contribute a little to supper, although my catch several times was taken by hungry moray eels before I got the fish on land.
Canoe inside the lagoon, and you see the plenty kite in the sky.
Sumai knew an old fishing method that possibly enabled me to avoid moray eel stealing my catch. He was a good teacher and showed me how to make a kite of a breadfruit leaf that, with the help of a long fishing line as tail with bait at the end, would probably be able to fish far more efficiently at the surface than a modern fishing rod. Kite fishing was formerly very common on the islands, but now it was only Sumai and another older man on Peak Island who could teach me. Sumai's son-in-law, Nikki, who had only heard of the method, also wanted to learn. The kite flew well in the air as we tested it. But before we got to the fishery, all of the island's breadfruit leaves were destroyed. After 6 weeks on peak, suddenly something happened that changed everything. It was announced over the radio that a typhoon was coming. It had been named Typhoon Mesak and was heading for the islands. Along with Somai and Nikki, I stood near the beach and saw the first giant wave broke into the reef and rolled farther up above the beach. So my hut was flooded and we had to escape to higher ground and into the island school. It did not feel safe outside. We heard many heavy bumps of coconuts that fell to the ground. We were about 200 people on the atoll who were in danger of being washed into the sea if it was high tide when the typhoon hit. We barricaded ourselves in the school before midnight. The typhoon arrived at approximately 8 p.m., but it wasn't until 1 hour after midnight, at approximately 1 a.m., that the center of the typhoon hit with full power and wind speed of 140 miles per hour. Outside, it sounded as if the world was about to go down. There was a crazy orchestra of noisy, torrential sounds from all sides. Later we were told there had been gusts up to 160 miles per hour. When daylight came, many wanted to go outside in the storm and rain to see how extensive the damage was. Alona, of 2.5 years old, a grandchild of Chief Somai, had, like everyone else, not slept much. So it was a tired little girl who this morning looked out on a world that during the night had changed dramatically. While watching the kids, I realized that they might have children of their own before it will be possible to find shade where the trees now lay toppled and broken. Some places it was utter chaos and impossible to get around. Considering the power of the strong winds the typhoon had brought, I was surprised there were still huts left on the island. A palm tree I walked by in the forest had been pushed so hard by the wind that the boat trunk formed an arc which stood as a portal amidst the windswept palm forest. It was worse where the waves in many places had destroyed the coast and eaten several yards inland, making the island even smaller. So there was now sandy beach and fallen coconut trees helter-skelter where before there was land. The taro patches was swamped by 1 meter of salt water and completely destroyed. The soil was destroyed by salt water and the land made impossible to cultivate for several years. Freshwater wells were flooded by seawater as well, and some of them covered by a thick layer of sand so that the well had disappeared. There were 96 people on the island who had to get something to eat. All around lay injured birds, especially terns and their fallen chicks that had been blown out of nests. Consequently, the day's meal came to consist of wild seabirds roasted over a fire. The next day, two boats were put in the water, and along with a third of pig's population, I went to Fishylop. Here, a breadfruit tree had fallen into the school and destroyed the roof. Luckily, no one got hurt. A huge clean-up was awaiting. Thousands of things had to be repaired and taken care of. Hand axes and machetes were the only tools. In the afternoon, a big meeting was held in the men's house with the participation of all men. The actual cleaning was planned in order to work in teams around the church and the school. During my stay, many islanders had talked a great deal about climate change, so during the meeting, I suggested we made a call for help, which I would try to record on video and try to get published to the outside world, which there was wide support for.
Please help us! Our island is disappearing!
The action was quickly arranged and started in the water in front of the men house, which had previously been dry land. Then the procession went to the school and further through a tangle of fallen trees to the church and back to the beach.
Please help us.
Please help us. Please help us.
Please help us.
A couple of days after the typhoon, the rain poured down. A huge clean-up was awaiting. Thousands of things had to be repaired and taken care of. Hand axes and machetes were the only tools. The time that followed was difficult.
Thank you.
people living on tiny, isolated atolls are among the smallest emitters of greenhouse gases. The situation exposes a lack of climate justice and the need of compensation for lost land and help from the global community. Climate change causes rising sea levels, dead coral reefs and more intense storms. Typhoon Masak was a Category 5 super typhoon in the record books. The worst typhoon that had hit Yap Outer Islands for over 50 years. 3 weeks after Fishailab Atoll was devastated by Typhoon Masak, a cargo ship from the central government of the Federated States of Micronesia brought relief in the form of medicine, bags of rice, boxes of canned food, and clean bottled drinking water. A few months later, the state of Yap in Micronesia was declared in a state of emergency due to extreme heat and drought that lasted for almost half a year, and which meant that the last crops and the coral garden west of Peak Island died. Less than a year after the typhoon, about 10% of the island's population had moved to Yap, Guam and other islands in the Western Pacific, where several island nations are expected to be depopulated and disappear over the next few decades due to rising sea levels caused by climate change. In the near future, this film might be a historic document which can tell coming generations a bit about the time before Exodus and what it was like back then when there were still people living on far islands in Micronesia.